Remember how in Dostoevsky's story of the Grand Inquisitor, during the second coming of Christ, this head of the church actually rejects Christ and puts him in prison, but Jesus kisses him, the Christ figure, I should say, kisses the Grand Inquisitor, and the Grand Inquisitor, when he leaves the prison, he leaves just a crack of the door open in order for Christ to potentially leave the prison and in fact take his rightful place as the supreme head of the church. Well, that was Dostoevsky's way of writing a polemical attack against the Christianity of his day, while also leaving a door cracked open for hope that maybe even the Grand Inquisitor could in fact recognize the Christ were he to come a second time in a second advent. The same is true with Soren Kierkegaard. His name, Kierkegaard, philologically and etymologically derives and extrapolates his meaning evidently from churchyard. And ironically, when he was buried in the churchyard, the Church of Denmark, his nephew started a riot at his funeral because so far from endorsing the Church of Denmark, in the Corsair, his newspaper that he would write, he too was writing polemical attacks against the Church of Denmark because he wasn't for Christendom, though he himself loved Jesus. I kind of find myself in a place that isn't too dissimilar from those figures. Like Chrysostom, who introduced church reform and is excommunicated from the church, I don't feel like my calling is to speak from a Christian POV. I definitely don't feel called to be a pastor. I feel called to build a philosophy. I don't know if you've noticed in my messages, but what I'm really trying to do is to build and spread a philosophy of hope to a generation that is embattled by despair and depression. That being said, with my roots so firmly established in scripture, I've spent my life studying it, and what I've learned is that you can expound upon profound biblical insight without subscribing to a particular religious tradition. And so I want to talk to you today about how I believe Christianity has lost its way. And instead of just being critical, I want to say, I believe there's a way back, and this is just one person's perspective, although I, of course, believe this is a true perspective, in regards to how we can get to a place wherein we affect and impact culture. But first, I kind of got to give a polemical thing. I think that we've really allowed church to get in bed with empire. It's like Jesus for president, Trump for vice president. Whether or not you like Trump is completely irrelevant. It's just the God and country message is so overwhelming that if you don't vote in a certain political persuasion sort of way, then you also are excommunicated. But it's not just that. It's the church being among the most judgmental group of people on the earth today. It seems like, I should say. And so what do we do to find our way back? Well, I believe we're not to condemn culture, criticize culture, overly condone culture, although we want to be loving and tolerant. We're not to be people who are endlessly censoring culture, conforming to culture, or copying culture. I believe we are meant to affect change in culture. But the way we're going to do that is not by throwing stones at culture or excoriating culture or telling culture a certain way they need to vote. But rather, I believe we can galvanize a culture into understanding the absolute hope, the divine, the principle behind which you cannot go, the causeless cause, the unmoved mover, a higher power. Pick your poetical language, metaphors apply. But I believe we can do it in a way that's far more inspirational. And if we really want to impact the mainstream, we first got to go upstream. It's been said that Christianity is like a watered down version of the great moral philosophers who give through Christendom, or I should say the masses seek in Christendom, a sort of easy way to find morality when they don't have time to sit around and read dead philosophers all day. Now, because of the nature of what I do, like that's what I do pretty much all day is I read books and I'm studying throughout the day, and I basically spend my day with dead philosophers. But I believe that these philosophers, like Kant's critique of reason, it's the moral law in me, the starry heavens above me, that makes me shudder with wonder. Kant was writing about that in the Critique of Pure Reason. But I want to talk about how we can go upstream to affect culture in such a way that it trickles down to the mainstream. Similar spatially, I'm speaking metaphorically there, but spatially, if you impact the coastlands, you impact the Midwest. Likewise, if you impact the upstream, the lofty intelligentsia, that will trickle down to the populace. And you see this happening even in universities today. But I want to say, when Christians were at their best, I mean, they were doing some incredible things. Sam Harris points out, yeah, of course Christians did incredible things because they were the only ones, and that was the only game in town, Christianity. And there is something to be said of that. But I just want to remind you, like, for instance, Christians founded hospitals. The Bible is the best-selling book of all time. In 2021, it's an estimated 5 to 7 approximately billion, somewhere around 5 or 7 billion copies of the Bible has been sold. It's the best-selling book of all time. I mean, look at its impact on the culture of literature. Shakespeare has hundreds of references and allusions to Bible passages. Roger Bacon is regarded as one of the foremost inventors and propagators and proponents of the scientific and empirical method in Europe, really the founder of the empirical and scientific method, along with William of Ockham, famous for Ockham's razor. The simplest answer is usually the correct one. And these were Franciscan, or Bacon was a Franciscan friar. So William of Ockham was also a friar. He was a friar. These are people who were devoted to God, really, in meditation. And of course, when you're sitting around contemplating all day, of course, you know, Georges de Lemaître is going to come up with the theory of the Big Bang because he's a monk and he's sitting around thinking all day. Thomas Aquinas was the founder of scholasticism. He also was a Christian monk. Actually, from the year 1901 to the year 2000, over that 100-year period of time, 65.4% of Nobel laureate winners, Nobel Prize laureates, were actually of Christian persuasion, of the Christian faith. If you look at even Christian celebrity pop culture, back in the 1700s, the first modern celebrity was a preacher, and his name was George Whitefield. He was known as the first modern celebrity, and he spoke to 10 million people live. This is before social media. Ben Franklin published his sermons. He even, believe it or not, could say the word Mesopotamia with such evocative and demonstrative emotion that it would cause histrionics in the crowd. Like, it would actually cause people to weep. Like, you think the Beatles or Bieber in our day caused people, Leo Mania causes people to go crazy, or BTS or whatever. Well, George Whitefield did that. He could say the word Mesopotamia and people would break down crying. So basically, so the story is told, we see Christianity affecting science, literature, celebrity, scholasticism, philosophy. We also see it affecting Europe. If you look at, for example, Queen Elizabeth, she was the queen of the Renaissance. And I think this was the golden age of Christianity. I really do. She was the queen of the Renaissance. And Queen Elizabeth, she made the church think. She was really the one who established the Church of England as that which would think Protestant but look Catholic to unify all Christendom, which is a brilliant move. There's no question about that. But it was during the Renaissance that Michelangelo, for example, painted the creation of Adam on the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel. And Leonardo da Vinci, painted the Last Supper. And Raphael painted the Transfiguration of Jesus, right? Like, if you've seen that painting, it is gorgeous. I mean, it really does something to you. I was studying it a little bit today, the painting, and it does something aesthetically and viscerally on an atomic, molecular, cellular level to you when you read it. I mean, it's really incredible stuff. Gutenberg, during the Renaissance, invented the printing press, which is why Luther's message was able to spread in part so much. But that moved away from pictures of the artist to more of words, which are fighting words, because words define this from that by nature. So they're more argumentative and divisive than pictures, which lend themselves to greater abstraction. But be that as it may, the Renaissance was a time when the church was employing some of the greatest artists of all time. So it wasn't a subculture or a carbon copy of society at large, but rather Christianity was blazing a trail in pioneering a new path. And I want to be somebody who's original. That's why I'm trying to think and speak and live in a way that is ironically, iconically original. That's at least my goal. Jerry Garcia, the lead singer of the Grateful Dead, put it this way: don't just be the best at what you do, be the only one who does what you do. So I've been able to do a lot of Christian speeches in the past, and now I want to get to the next phase of my life, developing philosophy, a hope philosophy, and I want to be the only one who's doing this. I've never heard anyone develop a hope philosophy, particularly, you know, reading the great philosophers, studying the great philosophers throughout life, and then, you know, developing and extrapolating from off the fly a new hope yoke theosophia. Like, that's what I want to do. And I think the church was at its best during the Renaissance when it was original. It wasn't following what the rest of society or culture was doing. It was original. It was doing the thing. And I mean, even if you look at Paul the Apostle, how he was innovative in using technology to spread the Christian message. He used the Persian mailing system. He used the dictation of letters. He used the Roman roads. Even Jesus used the amplification ancient version of a microphone when in the book of Luke, he asked to borrow Peter's boat and to push out a little bit where he could sit and teach them, because when his voice would bounce off the water, it would become an amplifier. Have you ever been on a lake and you could talk to somebody who was also in the lake from really far away and you don't even have to talk that loud because your sound waves from your voice echo across the waters? Well, Jesus was using that kind of technology. And where I think Jesus and Paul were brilliant, especially Paul in using technology, was speaking in the language that the people could understand. And that's why I like to use right now, what's the thing? Instagram, Facebook, TikTok, YouTube. I mean, I want to speak the language of the people in the marketplace. For instance, in Acts chapter 2, during the day of Pentecost, when a bunch of foreigners were visiting who spoke different languages, it says that the Spirit came on the early church with tongues of fire, cloven of fire, and they began to speak the language of the people that they could understand, right? So each person who was visiting could hear, with the 120 in the upper room speaking tongues, could hear them speak their own language in their own native tongue. Sorry, by the way, if I'm a little bit out of it right now. I actually went to a waterfall again, and me and some buddies bouldered and hiked up there, and I almost toppled off the waterfall and literally almost died, or I just would have had a lot of broken bones. But I'm so glad I made it, and it was just such a fun memory, so I'm a little bit punchy at the moment, but in a good way, in a good way. But at any rate, in Acts chapter 2, it says that they spoke in tongues. It wasn't just heavenly tongues or angelic tongues. It was the language that the people could understand who were visiting. And by the way, this was a sneak preview of Revelation 7:9 when it talks about palm branches in hand, white robes on bodies. People from all different races and places, all countries and tongues are standing before a throne. And that's a unifying aspect which the world needs so badly. So one of the ways we can impact culture is through technology, right? They spoke the language of the people, the early church did. Secondly, and I think this is really imperative, we're going to impact culture through skill. Like, I feel like a lot of people don't understand that the Bible emphasizes skill. The word glory means excellence. That's one of the meanings. They said of Jesus, he's done all things well. Bezalel in the Old Testament was defined as somebody who could design artistic works. The book of Psalm 33 says play skillfully. Jubal in the book of Genesis is known as the inventor of music, especially by medieval commentators. Huram in the Old Testament was known as a master craftsman. Wisdom, personified as a woman in Proverbs, was also known as a master craftsman. Like, we see that there was meant to be a skillfulness in what we're doing. There was meant to be a craft in what we're doing, not just simply living our lives in such a way as to be carbon copies or a subculture or copying what everyone else is doing. No, we were meant to do things in a newfangled, innovative, and original sense. So we want to be masters of our art, just like this skillful man, Huram. And now I have sent a skillful man, Huram, my master craftsman, or Wisdom, who's known as a master craftsman. But not only do we do it through technology, not only do we impact culture through our skillful craftsmanship, but thirdly, we impact culture even through political power. If you look at somebody like Joseph, who was the second in command in Egypt, Or Mordecai in the book of Esther, who was dressed in royal robes and given great authority in Persia. And Esther, who was the consort or wife of the queen. Daniel, a captive in Babylon, who trusted in God so much that he ultimately began to rule an entire province. Or Jeremiah 29:7, which says, pray for the peace and work for the peace of the city wherein you are a captive in exile. You are in captivity in exile. So too, we can use political power if that is something God has called you to do. The problem is the way that the church has gotten to bed with the empire, it's no longer a winsome, I'm trying to win some by becoming all things to all men, attractive, charming way of doing it. The word charm and grace are the same in the Greek language, like a graceful skater, so to the same idea of being gracious. But that being said, in an like Daniel and Joseph and Mordecai, they weren't angry, furious bloggers, or whatever the ancient equivalent of that would be, you know, foaming at the mouth. No, these are people who were inspiring. They galvanized people to action via their charm, via their greatness, as opposed to being keyboard warriors or, again, whatever the ancient equivalent of that would be. But Paul the Apostle, you look at how he used his own intellectual power. So not only political power, not only technology, not only skillful craftsmanship, but also we're going to impact culture. We're going to impact culture through just being smart. Like, we need smart people if there's going to be any sort of resurgence of the Renaissance. Now, the world is mucked up by smart people, George MacDonald says. It's the clever people who ruin the world, and that's true. Like, sociopaths and psychopaths are usually crazy, right? Or usually very clever, I should say. And a lot of, like, serial killers are very smart and intelligent people. So I want to be clear about that. But Paul was so intelligent that he studied at the feet of Gamaliel. Paul was somebody who could go to the intelligentsia of Athens, which was known as a hub of philosophers. In fact, it was where Plato founded his academy there in Athens. But he could quote their literature back to them and speak in philosophical language and talk about the altar to the unknown God and say, as your poet says, as one of your own poets said, we are all his offspring. So Paul was part of that intelligentsia. So part of the way we impact culture is by just simply being smart. And the irony is, in Jesus's day, he was able, through his followers, to really generate a kingdom that impacted culture and spread all over the world. Like in Mark 9:1, he told some of his followers there, some of you won't even die until you see the kingdom come in power. Now you have to understand, by the time Paul wrote Philippians, less than 1% of the Roman Empire was Christian. And Jesus himself had never traveled beyond Tyre or Sidon. I mean, he was executed as a rabbi heretic by a powerful government, right? I mean, he lived in a place that was only 120 miles from north to south, 40 miles from east to west. I mean, Palestine or Israel was a tiny place relative to the rest of the world. Only 4 million people lived there. And yet, hardly more than 30 years after Jesus predicted the coming of the kingdom in power, his message spread to Asia. The church was strong in Antioch. It went to Alexandria in Egypt. It had, in fact, gone to Egypt, where they used to worship cats as, I learned this today, they used to worship cats as gods. It had crossed the sea to go to the Greco-Roman society, Rome and Greece. Here's a rabbi who was executed by a government, who never wrote a book, who never traveled far, and yet his message spread to the whole world. And the church, to me, has largely lost its way, and I think people recognize that. And rather than just being critical about it, I want to say, okay, well, I'm not doing the church world thing. That's not my desire. I do not want to be a pastor. I don't want to be affiliated with that. What I want to do is develop a hope yoke theosophia, develop a philosophy of hope, and spread that to a generation embattled by depression. And if Jesus and his followers were able to do this during the days of the early church, during the Renaissance, if it impacted literature so much that William Shakespeare has hundreds of references to biblical passages, and the Bible as of 2021 has sold somewhere between 5 to 7 billion copies, why can't we do something special? If Christians could found hospitals and invent the scientific and empirical method and be some of the early European advocates of this, like, why can't we do that? Why can't we be original? I want to tell you, don't just sit around on your, you know, typing on your, clicking away on your keyboard, condemning culture or just merely condoning culture or, you know, censoring culture or just copying culture or conforming to culture. Instead, change culture. Because if we're on this planet, we might as well change it while we're here.